Welcome back to your favorite beer podcast, and I'm here today with Lager, and we have a special guest today. We have Sake, which is actually Lager's brother. Welcome, Sake.
Nice. Thank you. Thank you guys for having me. I'm very excited to be here. I've been listening to every episode. You know, I've been telling Lager, hey, when am I going to join the podcast? And he's like, nah, man.
Lager's hating out here. He's trying to hide him.
Nah, dude. We wanted you to get on. Just like, Sour wanted us to get to make her the first, I guess. But
oh yeah, that's
what
totally
can you
fine.
Do with that?
Yeah, that's totally fine.
No, but yeah, like we always appreciate you commenting on our videos, Socket, and it was always fun to hear from our viewers. So we're happy to have you as our third guest.
Thank you, thank you.
We'll see what happens.
I'm excited to comment on this one.
Nice. Yeah, so today we're going to, before we get into anything, we're going to be drinking some Sapporos.
Mm-hmm. Very fitting for guests. Sake. Maybe sake, we'll do a sake bomb. Maybe, I don't know. We'll see. See where the night takes us.
Yeah. I chose Sapporo because I feel like all of us have really good... We all of us like Sapporo, I think.
And it's a solid beer for sure.
It's a solid beer, yeah.
Which one do you guys get? I have Sapporo Premium.
I also have Sapporo Premium. We'll see.
So we're all rating the same beer.
Well, I might have a care package that comes in that's for Sapporo Black, but we'll see if that works out. We'll see.
Whoa. You're timing it with the podcast.
Yeah, I'm getting I got my kill streaks up. You know, I'm waiting for the care package to drop.
Oh, my. Exactly. That game reference goes over us.
Yeah, so I mean, speaking of gaming, I know time that we first bleep sake. Every time that we talk about sake, Lager's always saying that you're the gaming master.
Yes, but I am the gaming master in a very specific sub area of
niche
niche of video games, because you know, like nowadays video games is very mainstream. Right, like there's know the guys that like to play competitive shooters all day every day, other people that like sports games, you know, playing FIFA all day, and then there's also the more casual, you know, party games, PC platformers, right? But I consider myself like quote unquote hardcore in the sense that I really like very, you know, like the highest quality of games, all the games that you consider game of the year.
AAA?
You're like AAA game?
Oh, game of the
year. I want to play that.
Okay.
Especially single players.
Oh, so you're a single player gamer.
Yeah, I'm totally like single player.
Yeah, I think for us, what was your first console, Sake?
Mine?
Would you have to say, yeah. Or ours, I guess.
Well, my first console, I think it was the, without me knowing, right? Like, you know, that the Super Nintendo, the SNES.
Our sister, yes.
And so we used to, like, before, like, back in the day when I didn't have, how do you say, consciousness? You know, like, I know that one of the first games I've played was, you know, Donkey Kong Country, the Aladdin game for this SNES, but that's my absolute first. But I always said that my first was a PlayStation 1, which was after that. But it's actually kind of a blur. It's either the PS1 or the Game Boy Color, and I don't know. Which one? Do you?
It's okay, man. It was the Game Boy Color. No, yeah, it was a Game of Color because we had gold, I think.
Mm-hmm.
One of our first Game of Color games was gold, and then you lost it. So
No. Someone stole it. To this day, I believe someone stole that game, and I still miss it. To this day.
How old were you?
I don't know, man. It was probably when I was maybe 6 years old, 7 years old. Yeah.
Man. Did you say that it was a teacher or classmate though? I'm trying to remember.
No. Like, one thing happened that I took my Game Boy Color to class, show it off, play with my friends. And I put it in my, during lunch, for whatever reason, during lunch. I don't know why I put the Game Boy Color on my desk during lunch, when I guess lunch was the time to play. I don't know, whatever. I put it in my desk, and when I looked back in my desk, it wasn't there, right?
The whole Game Boy Color or the cartridge?
Both, the Game Boy Color and the cartridge.
Yeah.
That's a tragic.
No, but listen. No. Like the next day, it was returned. The teacher was like, "Yeah, a schoolmate took it, and we find, you know, like they found out and they gave it back." So this was not the time where I lost the game. I think that the game was stolen by one of our, you know, like how do you say?
Mates.
Back in Venezuela.
Clean lady, yeah.
Yeah, but
yeah,
it's okay. The past is the past. We're now here. I have a giant ass collection of games now.
If all the games you could ever want.
Yeah,
that's true.
Exactly. Yeah, actually, it's more games that I have even time to play.
Yeah, I know, you tell me there's like a backlog.
Yeah, once you're young, you don't have the money for the games, and then once you have the money for the games, you don't have the time for the games.
Can you believe
that's
that?
22. It's ridiculous.
It's crazy.
So you said you play all of the AAA games and like the, you know, the popular single player games. So
yes,
in your collection, do you have like a lot of like retro games as well, or is it mainly just like, you know, what's coming out new?
Depends on what you consider retro. I think the most retro games I have in my collection are PS1 games.
Okay.
PS1 games, yeah. Those are my retro, because I think it's difficult to collect for. Oh, by the way, I consider myself sort of a game collector. It's kind of my hobby. But collecting for more older consoles is kind of complicated, you know, like for Nintendo 64. I'm about to list all the Nintendo consoles.
Nice.
The NES, SNES, and Nintendo 64. Those games are complicated to collect, so I decided to stick with PlayStation retro games. And at this point, like, I think I've stopped collecting older games. Now I'm just trying to grab all the ones that are coming now. Yeah, I think I'm pretty happy with my collection now, so that I can just keep moving forward with whatever games are releasing. You know, like, I think I've slowed down buying older games.
Makes sense.
I think someday we're gonna see you in a Guinness World Book.
Nah, man.
With like biggest gaming collection. It ain't much, but it's honest work.
No, man. You have no idea. Maybe if I win the lottery. If I win the lottery, I would buy retro like crazy. You have no idea.
I know. Uh-huh. I think I remember in where we come, well, the motherland, as we call it.
Oh.
I know there were some flea markets that we've been to there. We saw some of those consoles, like the really old ones, and it was always very tempting to, I don't know, get them, but then they were all very priced, like they were very high priced.
It is still very tempting, you know, like sometimes once in a while I went to a retro store here in the, is this Motherland? No,
yeah,
whatever you say this is.
I think that's what said in Motherland.
The state.
Well, okay,
it's a little hazy. Mm-hmm.
So from time to time I go to retro stores and I see the consoles and I'm like, man, if I had the money and the time. So I'm just like,
the time is thing.
Yeah, the time is and now I have a wife, you know, like, and you know, now I bounce ideas with my wife about my hobbies, right? And I have come to realize, yeah, time is very limited and money is also limited. So I have to make careful decisions. So with the time passing, I become more aware, right? More aware of what I'm spending and what am I. But right now I think I'm at a point where I right now I'm buying the games that I absolutely have to play.
What's the most recent one that you bought in and are playing or are planning to play?
Okay, so the game that I've most recently bought is Final Fantasy 16 for the PS5. Nice. But I haven't started that because not because of the backlog, but right before that game released, another small game came out that, you know, you might know. It's called The Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom.
Oh, right.
And that's
I forgot
that
about that game.
That game is about to be game of the year. This is like no questions asked this year. So
it was another hit from Nintendo.
I mean,
like
Zelda, like Breath, they just put out bangers.
Yeah,
I guess so. It's a short hit.
Yeah. So I bought that before Final Fantasy, and I started playing that before Final Fantasy, and it's like, okay, I gotta finish it. But I'm hit with this situation where, oh shit, I bought these two games back to back, and I'm only playing one. So was it a smart decision, money wise, time wise, buying Final Fantasy?
To technically buy something they're not.
That I'm
gonna actually play it.
Right. And I don't think I'm gonna play it in another month because I'm still, you know, Zelda is a very huge game, very consuming. But these two are one of my favorite gaming franchises. So I'm okay with what
franchises,
I did.
Yeah.
I'm happy with what I did.
Yeah. It was crazy, yeah. Like Final Fantasy is kinda big. It's like they're at 16. Mm-hmm. That's insane. I know you're also, because you're a big Final Fantasy fan. You even bought like the Final Fantasy VII,
yeah,
all the disc for the PlayStation,
mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah, and
well, that's kind of crazy.
And can you believe that Final Fantasy VII, I think, came out in 1997. I was 2 years old when that came out, and I only played it on the PS1. On 2016, you know, that is what I call legacy, bro. Like that a game that you know of, that you know, if you're part of this hobby or occupation or whatever, you're like, this is one of the games that I have to play. And I did in 2016, 2017. And to this day, even though it was a kind of outdated game, it's a PS1 RPG, very blocky, you know, like turn-based RPG. Mm-hmm. Damn, it's so good, the story. It still applies today. The story is about terrorism, like eco-terrorism, kind of, like, or how do I say?
It's pretty complex.
Like protests, like they're protesting that there's this energy company sucking the life energy of the world. And the protagonists are kind of protesting against that, trying to do something against that, and a lot of stuff, more stuff unravels. But that's kind of the pretty much the initial idea, and that still applies today, dude. Like that's, you know, climate change and all.
I was about to say, isn't that just like, I don't know, Antifa or something, or just having it? No, it's happening today, or just like socialist group kind of like, you know, fighting to find the mega corporation, and just, I don't know. The way you explained it was very much like this happened today.
I mean, it feels
crazy.
Like something
still
that
applies.
Could happen. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's just so funny. Like, yeah, that's literally sometimes art can really imitate life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and in the future too. Like, yeah, like, and then it helps adding that anime aspect to it with the blonde, spiky hair guy with a big ass sword, and to really sell the game home. But I think you really like story games, cause I think when we came here, we got a PS3, mm-hmm. and essentially almost all the games we got, we played. Like we bought the Uncharted games, we bought Assassin's Creed, God of War. Those are some like the biggest one that we were playing, I think, at that age.
Yeah.
And then
so would you say that Metal you played Gear like Solid? Pokemon and all those other like older games, or would you be more of like a Final Fantasy and I guess PlayStation more so?
No, well, that's a funny question because back in the day in my motherland, right, where I'm from,
where we're from.
So yeah, I said that we had a PS1 and the Game Boy and the Game Boys, right? And on the Game Boys, we would almost exclusively play Pokemon. I was, you know, like I was one of the biggest Pokemon fans ever. You know, like I love Pokemon. I don't know what it is about collecting little creatures, but damn, I really liked it.
It was fun.
And for the PS1 games though, I mean, we had a variety of games. You know, we all had like the Resident Evils, you know, other platformers like Crash Bandicoot. And even Metal Gear Solid, which was another kind of mature game. Believe it or not, when I was a kid, I couldn't play those games. Well, even Crash Bandicoot, I feel like I never truly beat it. But
yeah, because it's always hard.
They are hard, right? But Pokemon for whatever reason, maybe they're too easy, or maybe they're very accessible to kids. But
I think they are because we were able to beat the game with just playing your starter and just using it for every battle.
Yeah, so. I mean, I think the I guess how it's made. It's really just type weaknesses, right? That's all you really have to focus. You don't have to worry too much on mechanics and stuff.
So, yeah, I wouldn't even care about the stats. You know, I would know like, oh, okay, yeah. I have a Charizard, and this Charizard can kick ass. Most, you know,
we have a level 100 Charizard from the game Fire Red that we carry through to Heart Gold. Nice. Like, so it's right now living in one of our Heart Gold games, I think. Or one of their games, either Heart Gold or Diamond is there.
Yeah.
The Charizard, 100 level Charizard, because that's from Saki's playthrough.
Right.
It's just so funny. And did you tell me that you also like freaking won a Blastoise with that Charizard from your friend in like I think that's one of the stories I remember. It's like you were playing Pokemon with some kid, and
we started Pokemon,
and then you guys blasted because I don't know how it went down though. Like, was it like,
bro, don't worry about what went down is that I beat his ass.
He took his Pokemon, man. Like, can you imagine parting away with your 100 level Charizard? And this was you not caring about stats too. That's like kind of impressive.
Yeah, I didn't remember that, man. That's a cool story.
Man, left him with nothing. Because Blastoise took might as well everything. Taking it too.
Pink slip
is crazy. But to answer question. Okay, so that was back in the day, right? Like, then we moved to the U.S. And as Lager was saying, that our parents, you know, like, well, it's another story, but my parents did not have anything, but they were able to, you know, like, we had just arrived to this new country, and our parents really wanted us to be happy after this change, you know, after moving countries, that they got us a PS3. And what Lager was saying is that, yeah, we started getting games like Uncharted, Assassin's Creed, Metal Gear Solid, you know, like very mature games. And all of a sudden, like, something clicked in my head. I was like, damn, these games, these higher, you know, like, I don't know how to describe it, like higher quality, I don't know, for a more older audience. Because I was still, when we moved here, I was still like about to be a teenager. I was about to be a teenager. So, but anyway, something clicked. I started liking these mature games. And all of a sudden, I'm like, okay, I no longer like Pokemon.
Yeah. No, Paco was telling me that you kind of don't mess with them no more.
No, you don't. After generation 5, you're like, I don't like you anymore.
Well, I feel like that's the golden era, right? Like back in the day, you know, like GameCube or the Game Boys.
To be fair, Stout was probably in the same boat where like he stopped playing at some certain point.
Well, I mean, I played like I think shooters. The first one that I actually played like when it came out was probably Sword. I never really played the Pokemons. I was always like a Call of Duty gamer. I played Mario more. But
right.
Pokemon was more so like I played the emulators in like middle school and high school, but like I never really played them on drop. My first like handheld was a DS, so I was a little late to that.
Yeah. Man, what a jump in timeline, because like we're talking about Game Boy Color, he's talking about his Nintendo. Yeah,
that's a DS. Huge jump.
That's like three generations or two generations.
Pretty much.
Damn that.
Getting them.
So you were really never into, so what about now? Are you do you get it even after playing Pokemon Sword or?
So I played Sword and I've done run throughs of like all of the Game Boy ones. I haven't played much of the DS ones except for something that Logger and I have in the works. But for those, I haven't really played too much. I was always more of like the Mario. I played Guitar Hero, Call of Duty. Mm-hmm. I used to play like Call of Duty exclusively for a while, but then I just like expanded into other stuff. So I play like, you know, FIFA every once in a while. I play for the Need for Speeds. I think the Need for Speed was actually another really big one. I played like Need for Speed Underground 2, I think it was.
Underground.
That one is good.
It was good. Okay. One of my favorite games, and my game disc snapped one day, and it was so sad.
Why did you break them, man?
Pour one out. Dude, I don't even know what happened. So I think I had, like, my discs. I had this bad habit that I, like, I just put the discs in whatever case. So sometimes I'd open them, and they'd be, like, loose or something. I don't know why. But so it was loose, and then it fell off, like, behind my like, desk or my cabinet. And when I tried to move it, it broke. And I was like, no. It was so sad.
Damn. Yeah. That's super sad when... Imagine me as a kind of quote-unquote collector. I don't have a big collection, but if one of my games break now, damn, I cry.
I think, oh my god, that logs some memories of our childhood where like I maybe put a wrong disc in the wrong box, or like maybe there's a scratch on the disc. And you would just cut me.
No.
Then you would cut me.
This guy grabs my Kingdom Hearts 2 PS2 original copy.
Wow, specific one.
And he takes it. I don't know where he takes it. To his friend.
Okay.
Yeah. And then the game comes back to my hands with a hole in the back.
Oh, I don't remember the ball. Okay.
A hole in the back, like if you would have like grabbed a pen and stabbed the case.
How?
I have no idea, but I was very pissed.
I can't remember anymore.
I'm a collector, right? So part of the collecting is also the physical. How do I say?
Taking care of it.
The original case for the games is part of the collecting.
Right.
It hurt. Lager. Sorry. Beep.
Beep. Nah, but yeah, I mean, yeah. I'm sorry.
And we're back with beer number 2.
Yes.
I opened it, and as in our podcast fashion, it's sprayed all over my face.
That's why you can have nice things.
Okay, let's cheers. Right?
Cheers.
Salud. Kanpai.
Kanpai.
Oh, dude, my care package came through. So I'll give you some context on that now.
Okay, now.
My care package was Sour. Went to go get some groceries because she wanted to get some stuff. And when she went, I was like, let me know if they have this. So I have the can that Sake has, but I have the Sapporo Black.
Nice.
The dark one. And it's pretty fire. I like both of them.
Is that a stout?
Was that porter,
I don't know, I guess, what it is. Or... It's definitely darker, but it's fire.
Dude.
It, yeah, I think it's...
The porters are nice.
Honestly,
I think it's more Porter. I don't know.
Honestly, I try to find a special Sapporo for this episode, right? So, but honestly, like I went to two Publixes, and I couldn't find Sapporo regular.
Really?
And on the third try, I tried a liquor store that had Sapporo, but they only had the Sapporo Premium. So I couldn't do, you know, like, if I would have seen the Sapporo, which one did you say you have?
The Sapporo Black.
If I would have seen the Sapporo Black, I probably would have gotten that, but I couldn't find it.
It's all good. I know, yeah. I feel like back there, it's a little bit harder to track them down for sure.
Yeah.
Here they have them in every grocery store, just because there's such a big Asian population here.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can believe that. So yeah, Sapporos. We're entering our Beer of the Week. Yes. Segment where we rate some beers. Today we're rating Sapporos, and I wanted to actually, before we get to some ratings, I wanted to give some facts about Sapporos. Yes. Because that's what I like to do. So apparently Sapporo is the oldest brand of beer in Japan, founding at 1876.
Wow.
So almost 140 something years ago. That's kind of crazy. Lot. Yeah, a lot. Yeah, it was begun by this guy called Sebe Nakagawa, who was Japan's first German trained brewmaster.
Wow!
Oh snap!
That's yeah, from Germany.
Essentially, yeah. He left apparently Japan at age 17, which was strictly forbidden, according to Japan, you know, back then, and to go learn, eventually found his way to Germany, learned the craft, and then brought that craft to Japan to make the first lagers and stuff. It's kind of crazy to do that. And I think it was brewed in Sendai in Japan. And they use, you know, the main ingredient for Sapporo is apparently it's rice. They use a lot of rice with it.
Is it a rice lager?
It's a rice lager. It's a rice lager. And I think the can that you were drinking from, sake,
mm-hmm.
it made its debut in Japan in 1984.
Oh, wow.
So that should pretty...
Oh, snap.
Yeah, it's a pretty new design from, of course, from back then. The shape is inspired by a tumbler glass. Which I'm guessing is those glasses you drink beer from, like the ones specifically for drinking beer.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And then one fuckity thing is apparently they were originally made to be able to remove the top, so you can actually experience drinking it from a tumbler glass. So instead of that little hole, you just remove all of the top. So essentially, just a metal cup.
Damn, but you need to watch out from cutting your mouth.
I'm trying to rip it off. It's not working.
No. It was originally made. I don't think they did it, because I'm guessing it was probably for that same reason, Saki, that they didn't do it. They changed back.
Start cutting your mouth.
Yeah, it starts tasting more iron in your beer.
Jesus. No, yeah. but I like the design, honestly. Like it's comfortable, sleek, different. Mm-hmm. Because
very different from, yeah.
Yeah, because the other, you know, the other beers, the other 22 or whatever ounces beers, they're just so bulky. They look like you're drinking, I don't know.
It's like a tube. It's a tube.
A tube, yeah. But this one is like nice to the touch.
Yeah. Whoa. Yeah, do you want to give us? Do you want us to give you a minute?
Yes.
Oh, man. Yeah, beer of the week segment. What do you have a rating already? I know someone just opened their beer for the first time, so they might need a little bit longer. But I'm sure you've enjoyed Sapporos before, so you might have a ranking already in mind.
Let me have some.
Lager, are you ready, or do you want to wait for the next one?
I'll
give him some time.
I think Lager. I think Lager is ready. He's very. I've heard the previous episodes, damn, very opinionated on this beer.
Kind of. Dude, yeah, I love my beers, man. So here, I think I'm giving Sapporo Well, okay. Tabor is leaning towards like some of my favorite beers, so it's not gonna be a low score. But like, and the taste of it is really nice. I feel like it's less strong. It feels less strong than a Corona in terms of taste. I feel like it has a lighter taste than a Corona.
Yeah. You can taste the rice in there. Mm-hmm. You can taste the rice in there.
For sure.
But there's like a... It's a little hoppy. Like, it's not hoppy like a IPA, but there's a distinct differing taste that happens in your mouth. I feel like for me, Coronas, they're like, they go down nice. They're very light, but they're not as, they don't go, they're not hoppy. This has, it's hoppier than the Corona for me.
Yeah, like from the perspective that you wouldn't drink this, like, at a beach, maybe?
Oh, yeah.
You know what
maybe,
I mean?
Maybe, yeah. I think it's heavier.
You know what this is? This is the perfect izakaya beer. You just this with a nice meat skewer. It's just unbeaten.
That's true,
Like that's what they made it for. Because, you know, like, I feel like some Mexican beers and some beers that are brewed, like, here, they're brewed with that intent. So, like, you drink it on a beach mm-hmm. or you drink it on, like, a summer day. But that one's, like, it pairs so well with that.
Yeah. I totally agree with that.
That's true. So, for me, I'll probably give it... probably gonna give it a good 8.
Oh, an 8. That's pretty high.
8.
I respect that.
8 Dragon Balls. Out of
dude.
8 Dragon Balls.
That's actually impossible. That's actually impossible because there's no 8. I shouldn't say Dragon Balls.
it's okay. There's like there's different sets, right? There's the like the main set, and there's like the universe set, the huge one. So you could we'll figure it out.
Okay.
I should have done it for 7 just because.
I think that I really like this. I like this. Honestly, I'm not the biggest beer person. Sorry.
Okay. Yeah, don't judge.
Sorry, Lagerstad beers. But I also really like this. I don't know if it's my Japanese obsession talking, but I will also give it an 8.
That's good.
Actually, let's do something different. I'll put an 8.5. Pochitas?
Pochitas. Pochitas. Oh, Pochitas, right.
Pochitas, right?
Chainsaw Man?
Yeah.
Chainsaw Man.
Yeah, 8.5
Pochitas.
Yes. Okay.
That's gonna look so awkward, half a pochita.
Oh man.
But it's very possible.
It is very possible.
That's true.
It's very possible.
For me, I'm gonna wait on the black because I'm just starting this one.
Right.
But for the premium one, I also like it. It's very, very good. I'm still not sure which one I like between the premium and the black more. But I think for the premium, I'm gonna go with the 8.6. Gotta one on both of you.
Oh my god.
Is this a price?
Well, I was gonna originally do 8.1, but then you did 8.5, so now I have to do 8.6, you know? It's a very strong beer. I think this is probably I like the Modelo Negra a little bit more, just because I have that one a little bit more frequently.
Yeah.
But this one's a close, very strong second. So I'm gonna give it an 8.6 Zorro's out of 10.
Dang.
Okay. I don't know if I've used that one already.
No, you have not. You have not,
8.6 Soros? Damn. You should have said 8.6 Soros Swords.
Maybe.
So that'd be cool, actually. That's true.
That's kind of true, actually. Or you could actually have Soros Swords and then one Mihawk knife. The one that you use.
The little baby one?
The other chest piece. That's some good ratings. Thank you for pitching in, Saki. So talking about Japan.
Yes.
And locations.
Yes.
We want to actually talk to you about some of traveling, because I know you're a very big traveler, you and your wife. I try to remember.
We don't have a name for her.
What would you name her?
Let me see. I would name her.
You can do Lickerts too.
I mean, I would say she almost exclusively liquor wise drinks tequila. But I don't know if you already have a tequila.
No.
Let's go ahead tequila for now.
Oh yeah, tequila. Alright, yeah. Nice tequila. Yeah, you and tequila travel a lot. It's something that I think me and Stav, we very much admire a lot about you guys. I guess because you could just go out and travel, and you guys work for it, and we always love seeing your pictures that you post on Instagram.
Thank you.
Dope.
I gotta say, like, I have to give a lot of credit to Tequila, my wife, because she honestly play a huge part into, you know, exposing me to new experiences.
That's nice.
Honestly, she was part of it. I don't know if this is the time to go into it, but before I started dating my wife, I was very. I always thought that very, you know, like, I don't want to say close-minded, but very, I didn't tend to think outside the box, right? I didn't think, oh, what would it be like to go outside the country? You know, like, I guess I was always fine with just the internet and social media, you know?
It was always a thought, I guess.
Yeah, it was a thought, but it almost felt like unachievable in some way.
Unachievable. Okay, that makes sense. Because we're
it's very daunting.
It's daunting. It is daunting. It is. Exactly.
Yeah,
it's good. Like the first step to go for it, like it's just intimidating, you know.
Mm-hmm. Right. And oh. Yeah. Go ahead.
Hey, what was your first time going out of the country then? Was with tequila then?
Yeah, with tequila. It was, as Taut said, it was very daunting. Tequila was working for an airline, and you know, airlines have certain benefits. And basically she told me, oh, let's go to Barcelona one weekend. And I was like, Barcelona? I was like, well, what's in Spain? What's in Europe? I've never been to Europe. I never left I've never left this country before. But you know what? But I was 19. I was like, dating, you know, I was trying to be very serious with tequila, and I was like, okay, I gotta do this, right? I need to be brave and be like, I'm gonna leave the country, you know, I'm gonna confront this, right?
Wow.
And I told tequila, okay, tequila, yeah, let's go to Barcelona. But the whole time I was like worrying, thinking about where are we going, what's gonna
plans, maybe.
Yeah, what are we gonna do? I always think ahead too much instead of living the moment, which is problematic.
And we're back. So as you were saying, Sake, about Barcelona.
Yeah, so what I was saying is that it was very daunting, but I was like, let's do it, because I had just started dating my current wife. My current wife, yeah. What?
No, it just sounds like you're not expecting it to.
Well, we were dating. Wife, we were dating back then.
Current girlfriend, then.
No, but he's talking about now. His current wife. She's currently his wife.
Yeah.
Yeah, but if it feels like current wife is a term used by people who have multiple divorced wives.
I think you're overthinking it.
Okay.
I'm following what you're putting down.
My bad. My
your wife
at the time. My girlfriend at the time. So we went to Barcelona, and it was mind blowing. It was like, wow, there's a whole world out there, right? A different culture, different food, different people, different language, different architecture, different views. You know, like it was just. an eye opener. And it's weird for me to say that because I come from another country, right? I come from, like, I've already moved countries. So why isn't now so eye opening? I guess in my, maybe it was, you know, the time, you know, the age at which I didn't, you know, like, it was the first time in my adulthood, right? Yeah. That I've done it. So it was very eye opening. It's from that point on, I was like, wow, I need to see, there's a whole world out there to see.
Whole new world.
That's right. and my wife is also in the same boat. She's like, there's a whole new a whole new world. A whole world out there to see, and let's see it together. So that's kind of like how everything started. And since then, yeah, we've gone to a couple countries, and I'm very happy so far with the countries we've seen. If you ask me what's my favorite, you know which one it is.
Or what about tier?
You gotta give a tier, because I feel like your favorite answer is probably, like, I don't think anything will beat it, no matter if you go to, like, literally every country.
What do you mean tier?
Like,
well, like
S tier, A tier, B tier, you know, like, mm-hmm. Like, what would you say that there's any country that will be, you know, somewhere close to that level?
So your S tier is definitely Japan.
Yes. Okay. let's yeah.
And then maybe like
start
A-tier.
From there. Yeah. So you did Japan. I think how long was it? Like
it was in 2017.
2017. Wow, that's before the pandemic. It was before, like, prime time. Yeah. You also went during, which is crazy to me. You actually went during the winter.
Yeah. I mean, it was during the winter because I think it was low season. The flights there were pretty affordable. You know, like, from what we could. Yeah. From our knowledge, right? From the little knowledge that we had, and it was very affordable. So so that's what we did. We did it because it was affordable, and we were trying to do something that winter.
Yeah,
it was very cold.
It was very cold, right? I mean, to be fair, would you rather be very cold? I mean, I know your answer, but imagine going to Japan during the summer, because it gets really hot in the summer, apparently.
It does, yeah. And I mean,
so I heard. I would, as you heard, mm-hmm. I would definitely prefer going to winter, just because, I don't know. I just can't handle
it. Put more layers, but you can't, like, I don't know.
Be naked.
Yeah, that's not...
You can't be... That is true.
Jesus, that's a no-no. Please do not do that.
You know... So you guys went to, what you guys saw in Japan?
What did we see in Japan? Like,
yeah, I guess the karaoke. Yes,
it was
springs.
It was mostly exploring Tokyo. You know, like, Tokyo is.
Right.
I don't know what are the metrics, but Tokyo is huge. You know, it's a huge ass city. With very, you know, it's divided in towns or sectors or whatever. You know, we have Shinjuku, Shibuya,
Akihabara.
Akihabara.
Oh yeah. By the way, how did Tequila react when you guys went to? What was it like?
You gotta do that. You gotta bring that up.
Yeah, because it's funny. it is definitely something that the Japanese culture is interesting.
Yeah. I mean, I gotta say, we went to, maybe it was in Akihabara, but we went to a store that had basically everything. It was like a building, several floors, and one of the floors was a library. Not a library. How do you say where you buy books? A library, right?
A bookstore.
It was a bookstore. and we were like, all the books, not very normal, you know, a lot of manga. There is a section in this store that is covered by, it was in the corner, and it was covered by curtains. And we were like, oh, well, I could tell what that was, right? But Tequila didn't. So I was like, oh, let's come here. Let me show you this. So we go in and boom, in your face. How do you say it? Hentai. Hentai, your face.
That's crazy.
Like, and the covers, you know, like the covers of the mangas, they don't hold back.
They're very expressive. Yeah, they don't hold back.
And Tequila was like blown away. She was like, she had never seen something like that in her life. She was like, wow, shook.
Do you think that the sound of glass breaking from How Many Mother happened, or like?
No, not like that.
Let me ask you.
So I've heard that they are really into trains there. Was there a section in that store for trains?
Like model kids.
Yeah.
In all the stores, They're...
Oh, I'm sorry. Can I say something, though?
Yeah, go ahead.
When you said train, I thought you were talking about, like, running a train? Like,
the hentai section? The transportation train.
Oh, I thought you've been,
models
like...
models and stuff, yeah. I heard from like YouTube and stuff that they're really into that there.
Well,
I'm sure there's people that are at least.
Trains. It's very weird. I also noticed that in their stores, they have huge sections of model anything. Mm-hmm. So they have model trains, model vehicles, you know, like airplanes. And not to talk about model anything pop culture, anime culture, right? They have Gundams. They have, I mean, anything that you can imagine, really.
Like mechas. Any mechas, yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, are pretty good, those builder. I'd say the whole train thing makes more sense because there's something very niche. Do you know Super Sentai? You guys?
Super Sentai.
Essentially, Power Rangers.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, Power Ranger was outsourced to the U.S. from Super Sentai, which is a Japanese, you know, TV show drama, mm-hmm. which is for kids. You know, they have all the things. That's where all the food is from. And there is a Super Sentai season where it was all about trains.
Really? Interesting.
Yeah. It was the most random theme to do because you know, in Power Rangers there was like animals, space, mm-hmm. cops, stuff like that, and then there's a season about trains, and I never figure out why why they chose trains until what you just said now, and it's like, oh, maybe that is why the whole culture about fucking trains, mm-hmm. in Japan.
I mean, but they're very important in Japan. Imagine how groundbreaking, right? To your culture.
That's true.
Having trains and transport anything you want across land. I don't know. I don't know why it would, but it seems like for Japan, it was a big deal.
Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, the in terms of transportation, they got it fucking down, man.
I feel like everywhere but the US, though, because Europe is like that, too.
There's some trains there. Because it is a good... I don't know, affordable commercial transportation. I don't know. Like, that's like, those don't need as much regulations as airplanes, less work than, you know, driving and shit like that. It's just like, it kind of sucks that, like, in the United States, they just came away with it. Like, they used it for the Civil War, and I think as soon as they got cars or planes, just, no.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's like, there's like a whole thing about like all the airplane companies and all that lobbying against public transport.
Not only that, gas companies, mm-hmm. I think, also lobby against public transportation in general.
They basically just like are like, no, that would hurt us, so don't do it.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And it just ends up being like that, unfortunately. But yeah.
In the similar way that they lobby against renewable energy. Right. Or like, there is this episode from Archer. They were protecting this guy who had he's essentially a guy who came up how to get gasoline from algae, and they were getting attacked by someone, and they were thinking, oh, they're just trying to steal it. No, it was just the U.S. government trying to kill him to prevent this thing to get out, so that the gasoline company can still be, you know, the whatchamacallit.
That's crazy.
The monolithic corporations that they are. It was like, can this be? This may be fiction, but it's so true. Like, I don't know, or like it could be, because essentially what's happening in the political sense, just like, I don't know. Everyone's afraid for change, but
yeah,
you know, do. Now that's cool though. So what's your A tier then?
A tier.
Yeah, like the second best. Second best.
Second yeah. best. Let me think. Well, I recently, 2-3 weeks ago, well, for Memorial Day weekend, we went to Portugal. Yeah,
you're insane.
Huh?
Portugal. Damn.
Yeah, we went to Portugal. And Portugal. See. I didn't go to Madeira to see my boy Cristiano, pero. I know, but I went to Lisbon, and you know that you know Cristiano started in Lisbon. But anyways, we went to Lisbon, and I don't know why I had low expectations. I had low expectations because I didn't know much about Portugal, honestly, it was mind blowing. The food, it was incredible. Lisbon as a city, it's kind of typical European city. You know, like very big, very old, you know, the organization of the city is old school, to say, you know, like the buildings and how the streets are, how the city is organized, pretty much. Right. It's something that you don't see here in the US. But anyways, Lisbon was beautiful. You know, like was like you could go up. You know, like the city. How do you say you that it. It's in a hill, right? So you could go to the top and you could see the whole city. And it would be very beautiful. And it also has the, you could also see the ocean.
Yeah. It's like, God, what is this? Like a vantage point?
Yeah, it's just built it's built around mountains, like hills mountains, and stuff. Yeah.
Right. Dope. Right, no, it's beautiful, the food, and we also went to the countryside. So we went to a couple wineries, and something funny that I didn't know about is that when we were driving from the city to the countryside, which was where we were staying, I would see the trees on the way there. Naked, and when I say naked, it means like it was basically like it was missing in their its skin, right?
Skin, or like it's they shave it off. I guess
they shaved it off. Someone shaved it off. That shit wasn't natural, right? But it was all the trees, like all the trees that you could see anywhere, were naked. And I'm like, and we were wondering, oh, that's so weird. I've never seen that in my life. You know, in Motherland 1 and not in Motherland 2, you know, like, and in none of the countries that we've been, we had seen that. And when we went to the winery, they explained to us that they use the skin from the trees to make the wine, how do you say the stuff that you use to close a wine bottle?
Oh, the corks.
The corks.
The corks.
Yeah, the corks.
Really?
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, and we also learned that I think that Portugal is the country that consumes the most wine.
Oh,
all right, now we have to go.
Yeah, but that was very interesting. Very like that was mind blowing. I was like, why are these trees like this? And this is why.
Damn, that's actually interesting. I didn't know that. Dude, that sounds so cool that they're like essentially a country made for wine.
Oh yeah,
essentially.
Yeah, for sure.
That's interesting though, because you hear of, like France, you hear of Spain, you hear of like a lot of places, but you wouldn't think Portugal.
Exactly. I mean, it's very weird, right? Me neither. Cool.
Yeah.
But it's huge in there. And they have a lot of wineries. Oh, the wine is super cheap, which was great. You know?
Yeah. No, that... Say less. Let's go.
For cheap, real.
Cheap wine.
highly recommended, for sure. If you're ever wondering to go to Europe, in what country should you go, Portugal should be in your list. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think Portugal would be A tier.
A tier. Nice.
And we're back. I am on beer number 3.5. I don't know. Let's see.
I think because you and Saki were drinking like big boys, I think I could cut it as 4.
You guys drink like crazy.
Whoa. Dude. What? So a beer is 12. So this is 22. So you almost drink 2 beers in 1. That's why you're feeling it. So this is number 4 too. I caught up with you. What?
Lager.
Chaos. Sorry. That was very chaotic, like 5 seconds. But yeah, I did not know that. 22. That it's makes... the tall boys are 22, which is what, 2 ounces off of 2 beers. So pretty much.
I don't know. Honestly, guys, I'm halfway the first one, so I'm a slow drinker. My bad.
Hey, do your thing. Okay. No, you're good.
Yeah, you drink when you feel thirsty.
The can, the can one hit harder than the bottle. I'm gonna say that. I don't know why.
I wonder why though.
I feel it. I'll tell you. I'll feel it. Yeah. Or maybe I'm a lightweight. I don't know.
I don't know.
You says you are. You are a lightweight.
I am a lightweight.
There's some crazy stories, but yeah. So as we're talking about traveling, I think you're telling me off cam a very interesting story about Japan that I feel like we don't want to miss.
Yeah.
Kinda come back to that. Go for it. Circle back to it.
Yeah.
Yeah, so
we go for it.
So Japan, well, let me say first, I love Japan.
I just tear this country up, like let me just say
before I go there, let me say that before going to Japan, I've always loved Japanese culture from the pop culture side, right? Like I've always loved video games, and I've always, well, in my childhood I was really into anime, not so much right now, but I do watch anime from that time. But before going to Japan, I all I knew about Japan was anything that I've learned from video games and anime. But when I went to Japan and I ate the food and I walked the streets and I saw the people and I saw the views, honestly, like now video games and anime became, how do you say, second, right?
Second. Okay.
Yeah, like the first was like the real world Japanese culture just intrigued me, and to this day I'm a little bit obsessed with them, to the point that I'm trying to learn Japanese.
With Duolingo.
With Duolingo. And next year we're actually gonna go back to Japan for our delayed honeymoon. So I love Japan, and now after being there in 2017, I'm like, I'm all in, especially after going to an onsen. Onsen is, for those who don't know, onsen is basically the hot baths. It's very typical in Japan for people to go to hot baths after work, to unwind, you know. Sometimes hanging out with friends, hanging out with family, whatever you want, or even on your own, just to relax. Go soak yourself into hot water, and it's very relaxing. And it's very typical. So, there's many. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so as an uncultured person like me, what's the walkthrough of this
onsen? The protocol? Like,
in this particular onsen, and I can only speak about this one because I've only been to one, and maybe there's many onsen in Japan, so they might work differently, but in this particular one it was a huge one, in which you go in and you go to the front desk to purchase your entrance, right? And you, the person just spoke Japanese, so we were like trying to
hi.
We were trying to, you know, buy the entrance, but it was very simple. The one thing that they did ask us at the beginning was, do you have any tattoos? Because if you have any tattoos, in this one in particular, if you had any tattoos, you were not allowed in. You know, and that was very surprising. I was like, wow, I cannot believe this. There's a lot of people that have tattoos, especially in Motherland 2 or whatever we're calling here.
The U.S.
Oh, the U.S. Okay. Western, yeah, we're in the U.S. Yeah. Come on.
Western.
Yeah, there's many people with tattoos, so that shocked me. But anyway, so luckily, neither my wife or me have any tattoos, so we had no problem going into this one. So after we purchased the entrance, we would need to leave our personal belongings in some lockers at the beginning. So shoes,
right?
I think keys, bags, whatever, right? And then we would pick a kimono to wear, or a robe to
nice.
Wear.
Nice. Okay. So we cute.
Yeah, right. So we could pick any design we wanted. We grabbed the design and then we went to changing rooms separate. You know, like women changing rooms and men changing rooms.
And you definitely picked up the Akatsuki robes, okay? Right.
I wish if it would have been there, I would have picked it, but it wasn't there. So no, what? My bad.
What is the sign that you go for?
No, it was very simple, just lines.
Lines.
Yeah, okay, and then my wife went with flowers or something like that. Very nice. Very traditional, simple.
Yeah.
So we went to the changing rooms, and this is the crazy part. I was like, oh, we have to be naked. So, you know, like in the changing rooms, you have to like basically take off all your clothes. And once you had all your clothes out, you will put your robe. And after changing, you will go into a common area that had restaurants, games, bars, just to hang out.
Right.
Together.
Okay,
right?
After you're like, okay.
And then after that, well, you could get a beer, you could get food, whatever. Takoyaki. But anyways.
Takoyaki.
Right. Yeah.
Right. But anyways, after connected to this area, to this entertainment area, were the hot baths, the actual hot baths. There were three hot baths. The women, the men, and then a fit hot bath that could be, you know, could be enjoyed by both, by everyone, basically.
Mm-hmm. By everyone?
Yeah.
Which one did you go to?
Well, the first one that we went to was the exclusive. The
separated one, right?
Yeah, the separated one.
Okay.
And we went to the separate ones, and this was a whole new experience. I've never been naked around. Well, I guess I have been naked before. That's another story.
With other people, that's not your wife.
No, I have been naked with other people.
Okay, that's not your wife and girls.
In gyms. Yeah, no girls. Yeah, you know, when you go to the gym and you want to take a shower, sometimes the showers are communal, right?
Yeah, and I've actually never done that. Like, the communal showers.
Yeah.
So I'm like, this would be a
dorms
very...
and, like, some gyms just have the communal one, yeah.
Right.
This would be a very shocking experience for me, too, because, like, I've never seen... I've actually seen both of you guys' dicks. I think that's the time to say this. I think that's very true.
I don't remember.
You're better. No,
I don't remember that. No, mentira. Yeah, of course, we're siblings, so yeah.
We're siblings, so then. I think the bigger question is how I fucking saw Stout's penis.
I don't know. I'm not even going to ask.
Battle stories. So you walk in. Your battle stories, yeah. So you walk in. What do you do? You shower or do you like rinse first?
Oh my god. Oh, this is a funny story. So you get to the area where you get naked, right? Like, so you see everyone starting to get naked. I'm like, okay, I guess I'm getting naked. So you take off your robe and you take off I think you stay with your underwear, and then in this at this point you take off your underwear, right?
Okay.
So you take off everything, and you can grab a towel. So with a towel, I was like kind of covering my privates. I was like, I don't know if I'm ready for this.
I think it's yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Go ahead.
Go for it. No, you go for it, man. That's your story.
Nah, anyway, so you go into the area of the hot baths, and it's a huge area. There's multiple pools, right? There's multiple hot baths that you can go in. And you start seeing, this is the first time I've seen so many naked men. especially hairy naked men. These people don't shave. But I guess it's something cultural, which I respect. But you could tell who is not local, right? Like all the foreigners, were shaved. So you could tell who's Japanese and who's not.
Yeah.
So what did you do?
Oh, so
fall down or what?
Right. The funny thing is that I didn't know that you were supposed to shower first.
Ew!
Yeah,
you didn't do that.
No. I did not shower first. I went straight to the hot bath, and then I put one and one together. You know, 1 + 1 = 2.
Uh-huh.
And I can safely say that in the future I will shower before.
can you say something?
Yeah.
Can you say something? I actually knew that because I watch a lot of slice of life anime.
Yeah,
it's a lot of moments where they go to the baths,
onsen,
yeah, and yeah, you're supposed to shower, you're supposed to rinse, or you're supposed to, like, you're cleaning before you jump in because they think it's like a very dirty thing to do.
Yeah, no, like, and to all the Japanese people, I apologize, but
your public apology,
a public apology, but it will never happen again. Because now I know.
Didn't anybody called you out on that?
No one called me out. I think no one noticed. It's like,
okay,
because that's nice. the place was so packed.
Okay.
You know, like there was a lot of people, and
yeah.
I know no one called me about it, but then I learned. I know
you
what
learn.
To do next. Next time.
Yeah, so how long were you in the baths then?
Huh?
Sorry. How long were you in the baths?
Like in general, or
during that time, it was like, you took your time, or is it just like, okay, I'm done?
Oh, no, I was there for quite some time. I was like, I don't even know the time. It's you kind of lose track of time, really, because it's really good. Like, I don't know about you guys, but hot water is my shit. Like, hot water relaxes me, like,
yeah,
disassociated really, flow.
Mm-hmm.
And I really think it's so good about the whole culture of that. It's like, it's something so rejuvenating,
yeah.
And it's something so, your whole body feels it. And it's kind of crazy, like, it is a whole culture, and they're also used to it. It's like, they don't bat an eye, right? There's like, this is what I learned from anime, right? It was like, and it's kind of crazy. Like, everyone doesn't care, and just they're all in their minds just enjoying the powerful effects of this hot water that's so pure, or like supposed to be pure, but yeah, that could clear a lot of illnesses. Or I don't know, it's kind of really nice. I am so excited to go. I am worried because I guess to say now to my viewers. I have been tatted, so I am worried now.
Well, I've heard that they have like little, like, it's like a Band-Aid kind of or something. Like, it's like a thing that you put that covers it, but you're just kind of big, so I don't know.
No, but don't feel bad. There are onsens that accept people with tattoos. It's just this one in particular. Yeah, I don't know. This one in particular was a themed one. You know, it was supposed to be themed of back in the Edo area, era. So maybe that's why. Maybe it was old school. I don't know. Maybe they were trying to follow the theme. But you should be fine. You should go and find one for sure.
Although I do worry that are the ones that do accept it, they're the ones that accepting the Yakuza.
Yakuza.
Because
I'm not well versed in that on that topic, but I don't think that Yakuza is, you know.
I'm sure the Yakuza have their own ones that they go to.
Exactly.
I don't think they're gonna be showing that to the public, like.
Right.
Because it's like more low key. I don't know.
Do you think I would fuck with the Yakuza a lot? I feel like I could get very in there.
I hope you don't.
Dude, you're gonna come back and you're gonna be a Yakuza member.
He's gonna have a dragon in his back.
For real.
I want to for someday to have a pompadour. That hairstyle that they, you know, you know the Kusakawa from Yu Yu Hakusho? Sake? Do you know like the redhead guy?
Yeah.
I want that pompadour.
I don't know.
My hair. The pompadour. You know?
I don't know what you're talking about.
It's a thing. It's a hairstyle that they wear out front. It protrudes.
The red hand.
Yeah, the red hand from.
I think that's a 90s, 80s hairstyle. I don't think no one wears.
It's very old. Like
that. Yeah.
But it looks so cool though.
And we're back. With another beer and some more good vibes and good conversations. So, interesting story. I don't know about onsens much, but Sour and I are actually going to Japan in September after our wedding. We're going to go to our honeymoon. So, I'll hit you up for the recs. Yeah.
Oh my God.
That's why I wanted to bring Japan up again. Because I was like, I'm curious, you know, you got the recs and all, but yeah, man.
Oh, you guys are going to have the time of your life.
What would you be your biggest tip for someone going to Japan and your biggest tip for just in general traveling abroad? Two-part question.
My biggest tip for someone traveling to Japan, make sure that you try all the food, dude. Like, try to get out of your comfort zone. There's going to be a lot of weird stuff. But really do try everything that you can. Like, I even try mochi pizza. You know, like...
Okay.
Hey, that sounds good.
Have an open mind, yeah.
Yeah, just mochi with cheese. Yeah, open mind, you know, try everything. I think the cuisine is part of the, you know... The
travel.
The highlights, right? Mm-hmm. Like, the highlight of Japan. And try to do whatever you can to get immersed in the culture. You know, going to the shrines, look at how people behave. I think those are my tips in Japan specifically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
And traveling in general, man, it has to be the food. Make sure that...
Always hit the food up?
Honestly. Like, even though you feel uncomfortable with some of the ingredients or... names of the plates or whatever, like, don't be afraid to try new things, and that counts for everything in general, really. I think that would be I mean they're both connected, but make sure that you try the cuisine. I mean, are you guys into food?
Heck yeah, we're big foodies. Right. Gonna be partying, gonna be eating, gonna be exploring.
Yeah,
and all that.
That's good. So yeah. Partying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, segues into it. A little bit more on topic and more not on topic, but more like relating to our pod, because we talk a lot about our war stories. We're wondering, you have any fun party stories or just in general?
Funny
stories? What's the one that comes out to that?
Yeah. What's the first one that comes to mind?
Funny story. Okay, I guess we're going there. Well, I think that I don't know if my last college party.
Oh my God.
My last college party happened I don't even remember what year it was. I know that the lager was there.
I think it was either 2018 or 2017.
Actually, Stout, you were probably there too. I think everyone was.
I think so.
Yeah, everyone was there. It was a Halloween party. I know that you have mentioned Halloween parties in the past.
You know what it was?
Was it the one that there was someone in a like a teddy bear costume who also shares my name? Or was that another one?
No. You're talking about a wolf. A wolf head.
Oh, the wolf, yeah.
That shares your name. That was 2017. And that was the last party that Saki ever been to.
2017?
I'm pretty sure it was 2017.
Wow, that's crazy. That was so long ago. But yeah.
Oh, no. 28. No. It was
2017 or 18. One of those two.
Yeah, 2017 or 2018. Yeah.
2018.
It was Halloween.
It was 18.
Yeah, I think it was 18. It was right before my wife graduated. So, context, I graduated college in 2016, but my wife was still going to college. She graduated in 2018. So she was still going to this all college parties, these student organization parties.
Some say.
Huh?
I'll go for it.
Yeah, so I went to this party trying to hang out with the college kids, and this is the same college that I graduated from, but it was weird. I mean I realized that by this time I didn't know anyone other than you guys. You know, I didn't know
such
anyone.
Yeah.
And I didn't know. I didn't know Stout very well either back then.
So you're only really knowing me and then me
and my wife,
your wife, and some friends of Soju.
Some friends of Soju.
Some of those.
But they weren't. But they weren't a lot. Like, I don't know. It felt weird. Like,
the president.
Yeah.
Of the year. Yeah. You knew them, so because it was their party essentially.
Right. But
you got to. You got super drunk from the Colombians.
Yeah, but taking a step back, like the reason why I was drunk is because I felt so off. I felt so uncomfortable. Wiping off. You know, like I felt like I didn't know anyone. I don't know if it was the fact that I was already a professional. You know, I was a professional. I had graduated. It was a combination of things. I was already a professional. I felt a little bit off. I didn't know a lot of people. Everyone that I knew, you know, like they were on their own vibe, right? Like on their own, like
right.
You know, they're hanging out with their friends, and everyone knows each other. But I didn't know anyone because obviously I'm not in college.
Yeah.
So I felt off, and so my approach was, let's go to the Roman Coke. The Roman Coke.
Yeah,
the
Roman Coke. Yeah.
Roncola. Yeah. So I started Roncola. I started drinking a lot of Roncola, to the point that I got drunk. But the cherry on the cake where, we had some Colombian friends that like this liqueur called aguardiente with
not
cheese.
Not the guaro.
Guaro, which is straight. I don't even know what it is. It's straight liquor.
It's like super strong. It's crazy.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure it's like South America vodka, essentially what it is. It's very clear liquor. And it's made from like, I don't know, rice or corn or something like that. So it's very like clear tasting. It's just, I don't know.
Right.
Yeah, They were like aguardiente, and they're just doing shots with everybody, and I took some of those shots, and like that f's me up too, because I don't know, I think it's the taste of aguardiente. They're like I don't know, gets you, man. I don't know. But yeah, so it's you were strong. Taking that was a cherry on top. So what ended up happening then?
Well, everyone is having the time of their lives. Well, I'm here, like, okay, I feel it, I'm drunk. And then all of a sudden, my wife decides, my girlfriend at the time, Jesus.
Your wife, just
my
say
wife,
your wife.
My wife. She tells me, okay, we're leaving, And for whatever reason, I don't remember. Do you remember, Lager, why I was basically, I was left behind?
I think I know why.
I don't remember why.
It's because I think, because she was driving us,
yeah,
Emmy, to Soju's apartment, and I think you felt like you were about to, And then she said she kicked you out of her car. She didn't kick you out. You just like, you guys both agreed, like, all right, I'll just stay here. You go bring Lager, which is me, who I was pretty drunk too, to my friend's place. So you decided, I think, with your wife, that like, hey, that like, hey, you should stay. So you said you stayed around the neighborhood of the of where the party was, and my wife, no, my wife, your wife. I just keep hearing my wife.
Tequila.
She tricks me, and then you just left behind to the, because I think you guys both agreed. You guys didn't want to throw up in the car.
Right. Yeah.
No, that's the reason.
And I was left behind, and I was hanging out, you know, walking around. People say that I got lost, but I knew exactly where I was.
Or yes, not. You didn't. Do you not communicate maybe your location, or like they didn't know where your location was somehow?
Yeah. Now I share my location with my wife, and my wife shares her location with me, and I don't think that's gonna be ever a problem again.
Okay. That's good.
But I got lost to the point that my wife got worried, and she basically told her friends to help look for me find me in the neighborhood. But I was fine, dude. I was just walking around. I just didn't know where I was. But eventually I was found, and I mean, that was one bad thing. But then the next thing is an accident happened in my wife's car that I had to clean up the next day.
Oh,
damn. Yeah.
That's rough.
Then that and that was it for me and college parties.
Yeah,
that was the start for me. And that was a fucking rough one for me. I think that party was just cursed.
Oh, that's the one? Damn.
Yeah. That was just everyone died that day.
No, I think you're thinking of the front of the one.
I think maybe. No, I don't know.
Because I think the one that you went to you think of the first one in
I think
year,
you're right.
This is the Halloween party.
Maybe I was chilling there, but I just remember that there was a lot of chaos. Dude, honestly, we'll bleep him, maybe not, but was a demon. I don't know how he would always be drinking the whole night with everyone, and he would just outlast everyone.
Yeah, dude.
He was a demon.
I don't know. I think the only way you could do it if you sneaked away some. Like, he didn't really drink some, so.
Yeah, dude. I don't know, but I feel like I'd always see him drink it. See him throw it away, but, like.
I mean, there's some people that can't hold it like that, you know, like.
Yeah. It's just crazy. Well, yeah, maybe it wasn't that one, but it wasn't that far off, but.
Well, someday we'll get sake drunk if the beers wants us to. Yeah. And then, we'll get him really there. Yeah, we'll party with them. But, yeah.
We'll get a bunch of sake bombs.
Actually, there's an event coming up. Right?
Your wedding.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So there is. Yeah. So what's up?
Sake's coming, and then let's do it.
Turn up. I'm looking forward to it. I'm very excited to see y'all.
Yes, indeed. I'm happy to see all the gang. Have a little reunion.
That's good. Yeah, so we'll definitely get you there. But
heck yeah.
Thank you so much, Sake, for coming with us, being our guest. It was very awesome to hear you and all your stories, and we very much enjoyed it. And
thank you for having me. I had a lot of fun, and I'm excited for being called back in
again.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Real quick, before we end, I'm gonna give the Sapporo Black a 7.7.
Damn.
Way lower than the premium.
Oh, wait, no. 8.7.
Oh. Never mind.
Yeah, 0.1 higher. I like that a little bit more than the premium.
Okay. But yeah. Clearly, Stout didn't remember his rating.
I don't. I thought it was a 7, but...
So, is that a Stout? We got there.
I think so.
It is Stout.
It's pretty bitter, and, like, the flavors are very similar, and for sure.
Yeah, nice. It's like it has some coffee.
Yeah, I would definitely recommend it. It drinks like a Sapporo, but it has a deeper flavor, I would say.
Yeah.
Pretty good.
Took you though. Well,
yeah.
Come.
Cheers.
So, cheers.
Thanks for the good conversation and the good vibes.
Yeah. For the viewers, comment down below where you guys want. What is the place you guys want to go to the most in life? Comment down below. And yeah, let us know who else you guys want us to hear. And yeah, we had a lot of fun. Style and Lager, signing off.
Sake, signing out.